Hello friends, let's try to solve one another GATE 2021 OS question. It was asking GATE 2021, which is related to operating system. The question is pretty simple. We need to find the C library function which will always call a particular system call when executed in a single threaded process. So whenever we are executing any particulars of this particular library function, will it execute the system call or not? We need to check. Okay, so let's check it one by one. This is basically an MSQ question. So first one is sleep. Okay, if you talk related with the sleep part, the sleep is using a particular type of the hardware resources. Now, what is the meaning of this hardware resources? Hardware resources means that whenever we execute sleep, okay, it will go to that particular hardware location, okay, and from that hardware location, it will block its execution. Okay. So that's why the sleep would be calling a system call. So whenever we need to go towards particular hardware is basically a system call. Okay, then we need to always invoke a particular system call. A very basic way of understanding. So whenever we are having sleep, it would be calling the hardware resources. So we would be having the system call execution. Now let's say we are having a malloc. Malloc is basically used to increase or decrease or allocate the memory. Okay, so basically it is used for the memory allocation. Or you can say the dynamic memory allocation. Okay, so sometimes a particular process is by default given certain memory. Okay, so if the process is having memory, it will directly allocate and we don't require the use of the system call. Else, if it is not having the memory, then it needs to ask the memory from hardware. In that case, we would be requiring a particular system call. So I can say this particular malloc will not always call system call, always do system call. Okay, if we talk about the strlen, the third option which is given, it is a standard C function. It is basically a standard C function and it does not require any call of system call. Okay, this is a very standard C function which will never ever require any system call. It will execute only inside the C programming language. Okay, and the last one which we are talking about is exit. Okay, if we talk about exit will be using the hardware resources to terminate all allocated memory. So all the allocated memory which is being given to them, we need to terminate it, or we can say to release it. So for that part, we need to always call the system. Okay, so basically if we say sleep will call the system call always. So this is our answer. Malloc will not always call the system call. Strlen will never call the system call. Well, exit will call the system call always. So our answer would be 80. So always remember one thing. Whenever we require any hardware resources, at that point of time, the system call is required. A very simple and a sober answer for this. Any hardware resource, we require the system call the same way as we had done in the case of the exit, as well as in the case of the sleep. Okay, so I hope you understand this particular question. This is all for this video. We will be coming back with the next question in the next video. Thank you so much. Welcome back with one another GATE 2021 question, which was asked for operating system. Okay, so here we are given a particular code with a particular semaphore, and it is being told that this counter, okay, assume that the increment operation in line number 7 is not atomic. Okay, and it is given the semaphore S is initialized the value to 5. So the value of S is initially 5, which has been given. Okay, now what the same scenario is that initialized to 5 and line number 2 and the counter is shared variable to line number 0, it's initialized to 0 inside the line 1. So counter is basically 0, semaphore S is 5, and this is the pair of which we are running here. If three threads execute the function pair of concurrently, which of the following program behavior is possible? So we are executing it concurrently. Okay, so let's say each and every we are having 5 different threads. Okay, the semaphore S is having the value 5. Okay, so let's say we are having a 5 different threads which is executing this pair of concurrently. Okay, then which of the following behavior is possible? So let's say every thread execute wait S. Okay, let's say first thread execute wait S. It will decrement the value of S by 1, which will make 4. Second will also execute wait S. So this is happening concurrently. It will make the value of S equal to 3. Then at the same time, all other thread execute. So there would be one time when the value of S becomes 0. And all the threads are stuck in this particular wait S of line number 6. Okay, so it would be stuck at line number 6. Okay, so there would be a possibility of deadlock involving all the threads. Okay, so deadlock is possible if all the threads execute line number 5 and then after each and every threads wait for each other in line number 6. So deadlock is possible when all executes line number 5 at the same time. Okay, this is executes line number 5 concurrently. Okay, now if there is a type of a sequential execution, if there is a type of a sequential execution, so let's say what is the meaning of this sequential execution? It means that one thread execute this completely, it has incremented the counter by 1. Another thread execute this completely, it has incremented the counter by 2. Third thread execute completely, it has incremented the counter by 3. Fourth, fifth. Okay, if all the threads execute in a sequential order, at the end, the counter value will become 5. Because it was initialized to 0, all the threads can execute it at the sequential order. The value of counter will be 5 after all the threads complete the execution of the parent. Okay, now, so A and B, both the options are possible. This is also possible. Maybe they are telling that which of the behavior is possible. So deadlock can be there if all execute wait of S, and if all execute in the sequential order, then we can have this answer also. One. So let's say in the case of C option, in the case of the C option, what we can do? If one thread one thread, first of all, execute this, and it waits in the wait of S. Okay. So one thread execute, it reads the counter value as 1. Okay. And then it wait for other thread to completion. So let's say it does not get a chance, any chance to complete. So the first thread initially starts and the value of counter would not be 1. It is initially reading the value of counter. So it is basically having the value 0. That is my mistake. Okay, so one thread, it is having the counter value 0. It reads this value. And then it allows all the other threads to complete. So all other threads, means all other means 4 thread, will make the counter value as 4. Because it has incremented the value as 4. Let's say I am saying all are executed, say, in a sequential execution. Then after first thread starts again or continues, and as it has already read the value of counter 0, so it will increment it by 1. So then after, it will increment the counter value by 1. Okay, so I am explaining that this scenario is possible if all the threads are executing this wait as at the same time concurrently, then they will stuck here. If all the threads are in sequential execution, then this scenario is possible. So this is correct answer, this is correct answer. Okay, if this scenario is possible, if the first thread just read the value of counter and then waits for all the other threads to complete at the same time, so all other threads will increment the counter to 4, and then this thread completes its execution by making the counter equal to 5. Okay, but this counter equal to 0 is never possible. So in option D, counter equal to 0 is never possible. Why it is not possible? Because all threads increment counter. All the threads increment counter. Okay, so it cannot ever be 0. So this one is the wrong answer. So your answer would be basically A, B, and C. Okay, so this is all for this video. Kindly try to understand this type of concepts very properly. Okay, we will be coming back in the next video with the next question. Thank you, everybody. Okay, so the question is very simple. We are given a particular directory flow. Okay, so a linked list based directory implementation which is given. Every directory is having the list of node where each node contains the file name along with the file metadata, so a list of pointers and all the blocks. Okay, so we are given a basically a foo_name directory. And we wanted to check which of the operation will necessarily require a full scan. Okay, so full scan, generally, we require only when there is some conflict with other files. Okay. So whenever we are doing any particular operation on an existing file, the full scan is only required whenever there is some conflict with the other file. Okay. So whenever we open an existing file, there is no conflict. We just are opening that existing file which is present to us. Okay. So at that point, A point, we don't have any conflict. There is no conflict. No conflict with what? No conflict with the other files. Okay, but whenever we do B, let's try to think. Creation of new file. Okay, so whenever we create a new file, we need to check the name of the new file. Okay, so whether the name of the new file which we create, is it same as other files or not? Same as any other file or not? Okay, so in this case, we will require a full scan of, okay, because we need to check that whatever the name which we had created, which you had given the other file, whether it is same or not for this other file. So yeah, it would create a particular conflict with other files. Okay, so B would be the answer in which we would be getting the full scan. Let's try to see for other because it's an MSQ question. Renaming an existing file. Okay, so if we rename a file, it means what? We can again keep the name, same as some other file. Some other file info. Okay, so we need to do a complete scan. So yeah, it would again create a particular conflict with other file because we need to check all the other file which has been present. Okay, and whenever we delete, we are just deleting. We are just freeing up the memory space. Okay, so it would have no conflict because we are not worrying about the memory part with other files. Okay, so the conflict will be causing only when we are creating or we are renaming a particular file inside the folder. The only reason is whether we are creating or we're renaming, we need to check whatever the file which we have created or we renamed is not same as the other files inside the system. Okay, or inside the folder. So the answer would be specifically B and C for this question. Okay, so this all for this particular video. Okay, we will be coming back in the next video for the next question. Kindly practice these questions as much as possible. Okay, welcome back with one another GATE 2021 OS question. Okay. So the question is pretty simple. We are given three different processes with the CPU burst of 16, 20, and 10 milliseconds. And we are telling that the scheduler is prior having a knowledge about the length of CPU burst. We need to find the minimal achievable average waiting time for three processes in a non-preemptive scheduler. So if you are given a particular non-preemptive scheduler, then we are having an option like FCFS, SJF, LJF, priority. So these are the some of the most common options which is being given to you whenever we are talking related with the non-preemptive scheduling algorithms. Okay. So if you talk about priority, the priority is not given here anywhere. So by default, the priority would be same as FCFS. Okay. And we all know that FCFS when compared with SJF, the SJF is better. And similarly, LJF when compared with SJF, SJF is better. So here, out of all of these, the most best algorithm which we can select, which will give the minimal achievable average waiting time would be SJF. How the SJF would work? Let's try to prepare a Gantt chart and understand how the SJF works. So SJF is basically a concept which is following as a shortest job first. So here we are having 16, 20 and 10 as three different CPU burst time. Okay, so first of all, the smallest one would be taken into consideration, which is basically the 10. Okay, it will start with 0 and end with 9. So after 10, the second one will start, which is 16, which will be end at particular 25. So the third one will start at 26. Okay, and this would be basically end at basically 20. So if you say 20 here, so it would be end at 46. Now, if you check the average waiting time, let's say this is process 1, process 2, process 3. Okay, so process 1 waiting time would be 0. Process 2 waiting time is 10. And process 3 waiting time is basically 26. All are starting at 0. So if you take the average waiting time, if you take the average of all, so we add all of these, so it is 36 divided by 3, which will be give me 12 value. Okay, so by using this SJF technique, generally we get the best average waiting time. Let's try to check with the FCFS. If we try to check with the FCFS, it is generally having a first come, first out. So we are having 16, 10, and 20. So let's say the process P1 will be having from 0 to 16. Process P2, which will be having 16 to 26, and P3 would be basically from 26 to 46. Okay, so P1 waiting time would be 0, P2 waiting time would be 16, and P3 waiting time would be basically 26. So if you take the average here, it would be 26 plus 16. So 36 plus 6. What is 36 plus 6? 42 divided by 3, which would be 18. Okay, so if you take into consideration 42 divided by 6, so 18. Here we are having 36, which is 12, so it would be basically 14. Okay, so by my mistake, it was not 18, it was 14. So if we consider FCFS, we are getting the average waiting time of 14. Similarly, if you check with the similar in the concept of the SJF, you will get 12. Even if you try with LJF, it would give 20 first, then 16, then 10. Okay, so it would be even more than this FCFS. Okay, LJF, you can try by yourself. It would be more than FCFS. So that's why that would also be not correct. This would also be not correct. So your most optimal answer would be a concept of the SJF, which is 12. Okay, so the answer which you have got for this particular question would be basically 12. Okay, so here your answer would be 12. So you can try with FCFS, SJF, LJF, priority, everything, but the most optimal which you will get is 12 when you consider the non-preemptive scheduler and a minimal achievable average waiting time. Okay, so kindly try to solve this question by yourself one. It's a very, very simple question. You just need to prepare a Gantt chart of both and you just identify this entire scenario. Okay, so this is all for this video. Kindly try to understand this question and solve it by yourself. We will be coming back with the next question in the next video. Welcome back with one another GATE 2021 question of operating system. This question is related with paging. So it's a very simple question with context with the operating system. Which of the following is correct respect with the paging? Okay, so first thing is, page size has no impact on the internal fragmentation. Okay, so we all know that whenever we are having a concept of internal fragmentation, so paging suffers from this internal fragmentation. And why it suffers? It is paging suffers from it. Why it suffers? Because the page size where we are having a data, this is the page size where we store the data. If the data is less, okay, let's say if this is the data, then this much would be our internal fragmentation. Okay, which I am writing here, internal fragmentation. So it's basically the concept is because of the page size, whatever we are having and the data we are having, we cause the internal fragmentation. So page size has the impact on internal fragmentation due to which the paging suffers from the internal fragmentation. Okay. Second thing, we all know that paging always solves the issue of the external fragmentation. So we always divide all the chunk of memory into pages. In paging, we always divide the chunk of memory into pages, okay, which is of a particular size. So because of that, we don't have anything related with the external fragmentation. So it's a well-known concept, friends, that the paging always resolves the external fragmentation while it suffers from the internal fragmentation. So first option is incorrect. The second option is true, which solves the problem of the issue of the external fragmentation. External fragmentation means the size issue in between the different chunks of memory. Okay, so that's why we are having this, we are resolving this external fragmentation, because there is no size problem or no special holes problem between the chunk of memory. So external fragmentation is resolved. For option C, we check the paging incurs memory overhead. Yeah, so always we know that whenever we do the paging, we require a page table. Okay, plus we require the cache memory, a hardware support, which we call in the case of a TLB, translation look aside buffer. So this additional memory we require in terms of paging. To handle the paging, to handle this external fragmentation, we require this additional memory. So yeah, paging always incurs the memory overhead. So we require the additional memory due to page table, where it stores the frames to page mapping. Everybody would be aware about this. And this is just for the faster access. Okay, so that's why we are using this both. So it will have an additional memory. So option C would also be correct. Okay, the option D tells that multi-level paging is necessary to support pages of different size. Okay. So, whatever the page size is, okay, it will not have any requirement. Okay, so if we have the page size different, so no requirement for multi-level paging. Okay, so multi-level paging we only would be required. This is required if the number of pages, or you can say the number of pages, or you can say the quantity of the pages are high, that cannot be, which is not possible in single page table, or it's pretty hard to get in a single page table. So whenever there is a scenario like that, at that point of time, we will require a multi-level paging, and it is not dependent on the dynamic page size, or you can say the different page size. Okay, so that's why multi-level paging is necessary for pages of different size. It's not matter for that. Okay, so here the answer would be B and C. B, I'm again replacing, because paging solves the issue of external fragmentation, and C, because we are having an additional memory in terms of the page table as well as in the terms of TLB cache. So this D is incorrect, and A is also incorrect, because page size impact the internal fragmentation. So the answer here would be B and C. Okay, so hope you have understood this question well. Okay, this is all for this video. We will come back with the next question, okay, in the next video. Thank you so much, everybody. All the best. And-